So this course is an introduction to meta-analysis. It will include three parts. In the first part, I will present the definition of a meta-analysis and also the main steps. And then I will explain how to do a meta-analysis in practice, focusing first on the data extraction and then on the statistical analysis. You can ask a question in the chat if you like. I have the chat right open now. I will try to address them in real time. Also, during the lecture, I will give a few exercises that we will try to do together. So you could write your answer directly in the chat window. Most of the exercises will consist in simple quiz. So you will have to answer yes, no, and so on. Okay, so let's start. So what is a meta-analysis? So here you see the few definitions of what is a meta-analysis. It is an analysis of analysis. It means that we want to analyze here the results of previous analysis. More precisely, it's a statistical analysis. It means that we will use statistical methods to conduct a meta-analysis, and it's a particular type of statistical analysis as it intends in analyzing a large collection of individual studies for the purpose of integrating the findings. So there is this idea of integration, data result integration in a meta-analysis. In practice, meta-analysis consists in two main steps. The first step is a systematic review. At this step, we intend to collect as many as possible of individual studies dealing with the same topic. And the second step is a statistical analysis of the data extracted from the individual study. Historically, the first meta-analysis was published in 1904 in the British Medical Journal. This is the original paper. The main author is Carl Pearson, who was professor of applied mathematics. But in this paper, Carl Pearson does not publish a mathematical paper. He published a medical paper aiming at evaluating the effectiveness of one treatment against a disease named enteric fever. The question asked by Carl Pearson is whether inoculation, a particular type of inoculation, was efficient to control enteric fever or not. There was a lot of debate about the effectiveness of this treatment at that time. And some experts were saying that the treatment was very efficient. Others were saying that it was not. And Carl Pearson decided to collect experimental data from several individual studies in order to address this issue. In this table, you can see the list of studies analyzed by Carl Pearson. In fact, Carl Pearson analyzed two sets of studies. The first one was about disease incidence. It means that it is the proportion of people infected. And the second set of studies in part B was about the mortality rate. So in these studies, what was measured was the proportion of people dying from the disease. So in the first set of experiments, set A, you can see that five individual studies are available. You have hospital staffs, garrison of Ladysmith, and so on. So four of these five studies were conducted in South Africa. It was experiments done on humans, so either hospital staff or militarians. And the study number five was conducted in India. In the set of study B, again, you have five studies in South Africa and six in one study in India. So here in this table, you can see the results of the analysis of Carl Pearson. You have two series of numbers in two columns. The first number corresponds to a correlation coefficient. It's a correlation between immunity and inoculation. So for example, in study one, hospital staff, the correlation between immunity and inoculation is 0.373. And the second number is the standard error of this correlation coefficient. For example, for the first study, hospital staff, the standard error is 0.021. So the standard error measures the accuracy of the estimated correlation coefficients. So you have one correlation coefficient for each individual study plus a standard error. And the idea of Carl Pearson was to integrate the individual correlation coefficients into one single mean value, indicated here in red. So the mean value of the correlation between immunity and inoculation is 0.226. And the mean value of the correlation between mortality and inoculation is 0.193. And in order to compute this correlation coefficient, Carl Pearson conducted a weighted mean of the individual coefficient. It took each one of the individual correlations and weighted it from the standard error in order to give a higher weight to the most accurate individual study and lower weight to the least accurate individual study. And this mean value were used to provide evidence about the effectiveness of the treatment against enteric fever. In this paper, Carl Pearson introduced several important concepts. First, the first concept is that it's important to take into account errors in the individual estimates because some studies are more accurate than others. Another concept is that the studies are heterogeneous. It means that in some studies, the correlation coefficients were high. In others, it was very low, close to zero. Another concept was the risk of bias. As the studies are heterogeneous, if you base your conclusion on one single study, you may take a wrong decision. It means that it's important to take into account all existing studies or the largest possible number of existing studies in order to take a better decision. And finally, the last concept is the calculation of the mean effect size. This is the final coefficient indicated in red before, just in the slide before. This mean effect size is a summary of all existing knowledge on a given topic. And all these concepts are still valid and are still implemented in modern meta-analysis. The number of papers, the number of published meta-analyses in thousands across time since the publication of Carl Pearson. As you can see here, the first meta-analysis was published in 1904, and then almost nothing was published so far. And until the mid of the 1990s, and then the number of meta-analyses increased drastically, very fast. It was very fast. So it means that during more actually than 90 years, very few meta-analyses were published. It's only in the middle of the 1990s that the number of meta-analyses increased a lot. And the reason is that in the middle of the 1990s, an international organization was created. It's named the Cochrane Organization. And this organization, the Cochrane Organization, promoted a lot the use of meta-analysis in medical science in order to develop what was called the evidence-based science. The idea of evidence-based science is not to rely too much on individual experts to take a decision, but to collect all existing data, all existing experimental results, to synthesize them and to publish them in a meta-analysis in order to provide better advice to decision makers. And another reason of the popularity of meta-analysis is that scientists are now facing the data synthesis challenge. As more and more publications and data become available, it's more and more difficult to conduct a rigorous and comprehensive assessment. When you have only one paper or two papers, it's easy to present them in a synthetic way. But when you have 100 or 200 of papers dealing with the same topic, it's much more difficult, of course, to synthesize their results rigorously. And meta-analysis appears as a key tool for synthesizing a large number of individual studies in an efficient and transparent manner. To illustrate this challenge, I give here an example. This example illustrates the explosion of the number of papers on climate change. So here you have the year indicated in the x-axis and the number of publications in the y-axis. So each bar corresponds to 1 year. It's the number of papers published on climate change that year. So you see that in the 80s and early 90s, the number of papers on climate change was relatively small. And then it increased a lot. And now we have more than, I don't know, sometimes 30,000 papers almost every year. It's a huge amount of papers. And what you can see as well is the colors. The colors correspond to assessment reports. Is a report published by the IPCC. The IPCC is the organization, the international organization under the umbrella of the United Nations, responsible for publishing a report on climate change, assessment report, etc. And in red, you have in dark green, you have the period covered by the fifth assessment report. So you see that at the time of the first assessment report, so in 1990, the number of papers that were available was relatively small. It was 1,697 papers. While at the time of the fifth assessment report, IAR5, the scientists had to synthesize something like 108,000 papers. So of course, it's much more difficult to synthesize more than 100,000 papers than to synthesize 107,000 papers. And if you look at the number of papers quoted in the first assessment report, You can see that about 63% of the published literature was cited in the first assessment report, or was cited in the fifth assessment report, which is less than one-fourth. It means that the representativeness of the studies quoted in assessment report 5 is questionable because only one paper out of four are cited in this report. And some people now question the quality, in fact, of the synthesis provided by this assessment report because they have difficulty to deal with the challenge of the explosion of the number of papers. And in this context, a meta-analysis appears as a possible solution in order to help the scientists to synthesize effectively a very large number of papers. Yes, so I skip this. Yes, one moment, please. I change the system. Yes. Okay, so now let's see how to do a meta-analysis, so the main steps. So first, you have to understand that the main objective of a meta-analysis is to estimate the mean effect size from a set of individual experiments. So each experiment consists include one control and one treatment. So sometimes it can include several control and several treatments, but I start with a simple design, including only one single control and one single treatment. So the control, in the control, we measure some quantity. I name the quantity XC. And in the treatment, we measure the same quantity and the value taken by this quantity is XT. And now the effect size is equal to XT divided by XC. So I give you just here a few examples. So so for example, this is an experiment for assessing a treatment again a disease. So in the control you have absence of treatment, and in the experimental treatment you have the tested treatment. So it can be some chemicals, for example. And then in the control, you measure the mortality rate. It takes a value XC. And in the treatment, you measure as well the mortality rate. It takes a value XT. And then the effect size here is a ratio between the mortality rate in the treatment and the mortality rate in the control. So if in this case, if the ratio is higher than one, it means that you increase the mortality rate with the treatment, showing that the treatment is not at all efficient, maybe even dangerous. But if the effect size is lower than one, it means that the treatment has some level of effectiveness and is able to reduce the mortality rate. Now, this is another example of experiment. So now it's an example on animal feeding, a livestock experiment, if you like. So here, the purpose of this experiment is to test a new feeding strategy compared to reference feeding strategy. The control is a reference and the treatment is the new feeding strategy. And here, the outcome of interest is the animal weight. It takes a value XC in the control and XT in the treatment, and the effect size is the difference between the animal weight in the treatment and in the control. This is again another type of experiment. Now it's an experiment in agricultural science. The purpose of this experiment is to compare the crop yield in organic and conventional cropping systems. So the outcome of interest is crop yield. We measure it as XT in the organic cropping system and as XC in the control, that is in the conventional cropping system. And now the effect size is the crop yield ratio. So if the ratio is lower than one, it indicates a yield loss in the organic cropping system. The idea of meta-analysis is to collect a large number of experiments like this one and to find a clever way to synthesize all the results into a single number named mean effect size. Meta-analyses are often used to deal with very controversial topics in many areas of science, in particular in human health. For example, here you have a recent meta-analysis published on the impact of exposure of to glyphosate-based herbicides on cancers. On a particular type of cancer, the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So the objective of this meta-analysis was to evaluate whether people exposed to glyphosate, for example, farmers, have more chance to develop this disease compared to others. So of course, it was very controversial because companies selling glyphosate were not convinced by the risk posed by glyphosate, but other people were pointing on some evidence showing that an exposure to glyphosate could increase the risk of disease development. Another interesting and very recent example is a meta-analysis done to assess the effect of hydroxychloroquine on the mortality rate of COVID-19 patients. So again, it was a very controversial topic because some people were promoting the use of hydroxychloroquine to treat COVID-19, while others were saying it was totally inefficient. So this group of scientists collected a large number of experimental results assessing the effect of hydroxychloroquine on the mortality rate. Meta-analysis is also used to deal with controversial topics in agricultural science. And in environmental science as well. For example, in this meta-analysis, the author conducted a meta-analysis to evaluate the impact of genetically modified crops on both environments and the productivity of different crops. And in this one, the author conducted a meta-analysis to evaluate the effect of neonicotinoid insecticide on honeybees. So neonicotinoid is a controversial insecticide. A lot of people consider that it has a big impact on the mortality rate of bees. And this meta-analysis synthesized a large number of experiments on this topic. And this meta-analysis is also an interesting example. It synthesized a large number of experiments assessing the effect of climate change on crop yields. As you know, a lot of scientists consider that climate change will induce yield losses, but others consider that on the opposite, it could increase crop yields. And this also synthesized many experiments in order to evaluate the impact of climate change on crop yields. So this was the first part of my presentation. So the objective was to define what is a meta-analysis and to present the objective. Now I will show the main steps of a meta-analysis, but if you have questions, you can ask a few questions if you like. Don't hesitate. Um, So you have to keep in mind that in order to make a high-quality meta-analysis, you have to go through a number of steps, and that it takes time. You cannot do a meta-analysis in 1 hour. You need usually a few months to do a meta-analysis, and I will explain why. So here you can see the main step of a meta-analysis. So basically, there are six steps: scoping, literature search, paper selection, data extraction, statistical analysis, bias, and uncertainty. The first step takes usually a few hours. At this step, you define the objective of the meta-analysis, you define the effect size you want to estimate. The second step is not too long as well. It's a literature search, so you have to choose one or two scientific databases like Web of Science or Scopus or PubMed, and then you have to define search equations to conduct the search and to get the list of papers. So it's not very long. Of course, you have to fine-tune the search equations. You have to play a little bit with keywords, but it's not a big work, usually. What is long is the paper selection and data extraction. Paper selection means that you have to screen all the papers retrieved by the literature search. And this can be, and check that these papers are relevant for your work. This can take several days or work. And what is very long is the data extractions. Data extraction, you mean that you have to extract the data from each paper, data from tables and from figures. Usually you need at least 1 day for two papers, or 1 half day per paper. So if you have 100 papers, it means at least 50 days. So it's several months of work. Then once the data extracted, you have to perform a statistical analysis. It takes 1 or 2 days. And finally, you have to analyze the bias in your analysis, the risk of bias, and to assess uncertainty. It takes 1 to a couple of hours. So basically, because of the paper selection and data extraction steps, it's very difficult to perform a meta-analysis in less than 2-3 months. And usually, it took 6 months, even more, to do a good quality meta-analysis. If you look more carefully at these six steps, you can see two subgroups. The first subgroup includes the first three steps: scoping, literature search, paper selection. It corresponds to a systematic review. A systematic review can be done without a meta-analysis. You can do a systematic review alone and publish the results. But what makes the meta-analysis very specific is the second part, is the statistical analysis part. I will not spend a lot of time on the procedure on systematic review, but I will recall some basic principles. When you do a systematic review, you have to type a search equation here. This is the interface of Web of Science. So you define a search equation and you write it here, you tap on search, and you get a list of papers including these keywords. Of course, you can do that using a second or third scientific database. For example, you can use Scopus, or you can use PubMed, or other databases. You can even use Google Scholar, for example. And usually it's recommended to use at least two databases in order to be able to retrieve the largest possible number of papers. So here, when you will run your search equation, you will get a series of papers. So here is just a few examples of output of Web of Science. So you have title and abstract, and you can already screen the papers to check that they are relevant for your own analysis. So here you can see, so here it was a search done to retrieve papers dealing with soil disinfestation against pest and disease. So that's why you have soil disinfestation highlighted in yellow here. The second series of steps, the second subgroup of steps, aims at performing a quantitative estimation. So it's data extraction, statistical analysis, assessment of bias and uncertainty. So this second group of this second part makes the originality of a meta-analysis. In fact, you can see a meta-analysis as a quantitative systematic review. Meta-analysis is equal to a systematic review plus a quantitative estimation, so it's a quantitative systematic review. But it means that the quality of the results that you will get from a meta-analysis depends on both the quality of the systematic review and the quality of data extraction and statistical analysis. It's very important to keep that in mind, because even if you spend a lot of time on the statistical analysis, if the systematic review was not correctly conducted, the quality of the result will be low. So it's very important to be very systematic in the review of the literature. So here, just an example to see what is a meta-analysis in agricultural science. So here it's a meta-analysis assessing the soil carbon stock and sequestration of soil carbon in agroforestry systems compared to standard cropping systems without tree. So the idea of this meta-analysis was to collect a large number of experiments so here it's just 9 experiments, but there are many more in these papers. It's just for illustration. So for example, in experiment 1, the author published that agroforestry would increase soil carbon by 10% plus or minus 4%. The 4% here is the standard error. In experiment 2, the author published that agroforestry will increase soil carbon by 20% with the standard error plus or minus 7, and so on. And in some experiments, for example, in experiment A, the author did not find any effect of agroforestry. And in experiment 9, then even found a decrease with a relatively large standard error. So here, what you have is typical. You have a set of experiments, and you have a big heterogeneity in the results. So sometimes you have no effect, sometimes you have a positive effect. Sometimes you have a negative effect, and the level of accuracy of the results is different. Sometimes the standard error is only 2%. But for example, in experiment 7, the standard error is very high, it's 10%. So here in this context, if you ask an expert to conclude about the effect of agroforestry on soil carbon stock, if you pick up an expert knowing only experiment 2 and experiment 7, the conclusion will be a strong effect. But if you ask another expert basing his or her opinion on the three experiments showing no effect, The expert will say that agroforestry has no effect. So here in this simple example, we see that opinion-based approach can be very dangerous. It can lead to high risk of bias. It can. There is no formal analysis of what is known and no reliable identification of knowledge gaps. So of course, what we like when we do a meta-analysis is to shift from an opinion-based approach to an evidence-based approach in which we try to synthesize everything without bias or with the lowest possible level of bias. But what we will do in a meta-analysis is to review all experiments. We will not choose a subset of experiments. We will use all of them. And we will provide a global quantitative synthesis of all their results. So here, if we want to perform a meta-analysis on this topic, agroforestry impact on the soil carbon, we'll first define the objective. And here the objective, and it was the objective of this paper here, is to evaluate the effect of an intervention, agroforestry, compared to a comparator monoculture. And here the author selected a particular type of cropping system. It was cereal cropping systems. And the outcome of interest is soil carbon. So you see here in the scoping, we define four elements, the population, the intervention, the comparator, and the outcome. And in this example on agroforestry, population is cereal cropping systems, intervention is agroforestry, comparator is monoculture, and the outcome is soil carbon. The step two is to perform a literature search. So we have to define a formal protocol. It means a search equation. We put the search equation in Web of Science, Scopus, and so on. And we retrieve all the published papers on this topic. Then we will select all the relevant experiments based on explicit criteria. It means that we have to define explicit criteria. Then we'll extract the data, put them in tables and figures, and in step five, do a statistical analysis. In practice, this is what we will do. We will take experiment one, published in paper one. We will extract the quantitative results and put it in a database. So what we do in practice is to draw this kind of plot. We'll see later that this type of plot is named forest plot. And we will extract the 10% and also compute a confidence interval from the standard error, okay? So the point here corresponds to the plus 10% extracted from experiment one, and the confidence interval is derived from the 4%. And we will repeat this procedure for each individual experiment. So here you will have no effect because you have a confidence interval covering zero. And here you see you have an effect size which is stronger, plus 25%, but with a larger confidence interval due to the fact that the standard error here is 10% and not 4%. So if you repeat the procedure for all experiments, you obtain this kind of figure, which is named a forest plot. And this forest plot summarizes all the experimental results extracted from the individual studies. And the last step is to synthesize all these black points into a single value named mean effect size. Mean effect size is here equal to plus 11% with a confidence interval based on a standard error of 3%. And this mean effect size and confidence interval are derived by applying a statistical methods to the whole series of individual effect size. And we will weight each individual studies according to its own accuracy in order to obtain relevant mean effect size and confidence interval. Then we will communicate this mean effect size and confidence interval in order to conclude here on the effect of agroforestry on soil carbon increase. Now let's have a look at the results of this paper on agroforestry. So in this map, you can see the locations of all the experiments selected by the author through a systematic review of the literature. Each red triangle is one location. And you have two numbers. The first number is, as far as I remember, the number of trials at this location. And the second number is the number of data, because you have several data collected in each trial. So you see that the author conducted a global meta-analysis. And here you see the results of the meta-analysis. So you can look first at the black square at the bottom of the graphic. You see that so this author here found an effect of agroforestry of about 18%. Compared to non-agroforestry system. You see that the confidence interval is very narrow. It means that the estimate is very accurate, very reliable. So based on this black square here, we can conclude that agroforestry increase soil carbon content by about 18%. The author did additional statistical analysis for different subgroups. Subgroups covering different regions, different climatic conditions, different type of agroforestry, different time step, different soil depths. So at the top, you have the red squares here. The red square correspond to mean effect size values obtained for subgroups of experiments corresponding to different regions. So the number at the right of the error bar correspond to the number of data used to estimate the corresponding mean effect size. So for example, if you look at the mean effect size estimated in Africa, you can see here that in Africa, agroforestry increased soil carbon content by 18%. It is based on 83 data. In Asia, it increased the soil carbon content by 38% or 39%. It is based on 101 data. For Australia, you see that we have only 10 data available and the confidence interval is very large and we cannot conclude anything on Australia concerning the effect of agroforestry on soil carbon. And this corresponds to a knowledge gap. So this is also interesting. It shows that if we have to do more experiments, it's probably more interesting to do it in Australia than in other places, because we are lacking data in Australia. So you have other subgroups defined below. For example, if you look at soil depths in brown here, you see that there is no big difference in terms of soil carbon across the different soil depths considered. It's more or less the same. You have more difference concerning the different types of agroforestry in blue. You see that the author found a higher soil carbon content in home garden than in other type of agroforestry systems. Um, So I see that there is a question in the chat. What's the principle to make such equation? I will show several examples of such equation a bit later in my talk. But the basic principle is to identify keywords related to the topics you want to study. For example, if you want to conduct methanese on agroforestry system, iron and soil carbon, you will choose, of course, keywords agroforestry, soil, carbon, and maybe other keywords, maybe some keywords related to experiments, like experiments, trial, and so on. And then you have to link the keywords together using either the OR words or the AND word in order to find papers, including either one of the term or all the term together. That's the basic principle. And such equation can be very short. Sometimes it's very short when topic is very specific, or can be very long if you need to include many synonyms of some techniques, for example. For example, if you want to make a search focusing on cereals, you can write as keyword cereal, but you should probably also add wheat, barley, oat, rice, maize, and so on in order to cover all types of cereals. I don't know if there is another question at this stage. Okay. I will finish this part by a few examples. So here it's a meta-analysis on soil disinfestation. So soil anaerobic soil disinfestation. The principle of anaerobic soil disinfestation is to cover the soil with some plastic. And then to disinfect the soil, to wait sometimes in order to kill most of the pests and disease in the soil. It's an alternative to fumigation. So it was proposed by people who wanted to avoid any, to limit the risk of pollution by fumigation. And also fumigation can be dangerous for human health. And the question was then whether this alternative technique was efficient or not. And in this case, the effect size is a ratio. It's the ratio of plant pest abundance after soil disinfestation to plant pest abundance without soil disinfestation. So you have to keep in mind that quite often, and we don't use the ratio, but we use the log ratio, the logarithm of the ratio. And when the ratio is lower than one, it means that the logarithm is lower than zero. When it's higher than one, it means that the logarithm is higher than zero. And when it's equal to one, the logarithm is L is equal to zero. It means that in this example, if soil disinfestation is able to reduce pest abundance, the ratio should be lower than one, and the log ratio should be lower than zero. This is the search equation used by this author here. So here you see you have keywords related to soil disinfestation with a few synonyms like soil amendment, soil treatment, biological soil disinfestation, ASD, it's an acronym, reductive soil sterilization, no chemical fumigation, no chemical alternative. And you see that all these keywords is related by OR, but the two groups of keywords were related by AND. They use Web of Science, and if you do it, if you copy and paste, you can try this search equation in Web of Science, you will get a series of papers, and this is the four first papers, the first four papers retrieved by Web of Science. And you see that indeed, for example, the first one deal with anaerobic soil infestation as an alternative to soil fumigation for control of soil, some soil-borne pathogen in strawberry production. So you see, so here it's only the first four, but you have many other papers that were retrieved by Web of Science. The next step is paper selection. So here the graphic here illustrates the paper selection procedure followed by the author. So you see that when they use the Web of Science, they found 116 papers. And then they screen the 116 papers based on title and abstract. And they had a series of criteria to select the papers. They did it by hand. So for eligibility, the paper should correspond to field or greenhouse or lab study. They should measure pathogen suppression or pest suppression. They should deal with anaerobic, biological, or reductive condition as non-fumigant treatment. And here on the right, you see the exclusion criteria. So you have 40 papers out of the 116 in which no data were presented. 20 papers were not dealing with anaerobic soil disinfestation. And for 10 papers, the full text was not found. So at the end of the screening step, the author found 46 papers. And they give the distribution of the papers across years here. And they did a second search on Google Scholar and in conference papers, and they found 9 additional papers. So at the end, they got 55 papers from which they extracted data. So here, in fact, the authors were lucky because from the literature search, they got only 116 papers, which is actually quite low. And what is interesting and relatively rare is that almost half of the papers were relevant. It's not frequent. Quite often we have something like 1,000 papers and only 2-3% are relevant. So it means that quite often we spend a lot of time reading irrelevant papers. But here the authors were pretty lucky. They did not have to work too much because reading 116 papers is not long. And based on this, they were able to have a relatively large number of relevant studies. This is the results of their meta-analysis. What is presented here is the log ratio of pest abundance. The log ratio of pest abundance after soil disinfestation compared to a situation without soil disinfestation. Most of the pathogens were fungi. The black point at the bottom corresponds to the mean effect size. And you have a percentage at the right of the point. So if you look at the black point, the percentage is 61%. 61% is the proportion of reduction of pest abundance based on the log ratio. If you back transform the log ratio, if you take the exponential, you will get the ratio. And then if you calculate 1 minus the ratio, you have the percentage of reduction of pest abundance. It means that when the log ratio is very negative, it indicates a reduction of pest abundance, and the level of reduction corresponds to the percentage indicated, reported at the right of the point. So if you have 100%, it means that there is no pest and disease anymore in the soil after disinfestation. Okay, it will correspond to a very negative log ratio. Okay. In addition to that, you have for each point, you have a confidence interval. It's a 95% confidence interval that reflects the uncertainty associated with the log ratio estimate. It indicates whether the estimate is accurate or not. If you look at the right of the graphic, you have the name of the different organisms that were present in the soil. So for example, the first blue points in panel C correspond to Sclerotinia, it's one fungus. And in between brackets, you have a number for Sclerotinia, it's 442. It's the number of data used to estimate the mean effect size for Sclerotinia. And finally, you have a p-value. The p-value is a probability. It's the probability of false significant result. And of course, the lower the p-value, the more significant is the effect. So in summary, a result will show a high level of effectiveness of soil disinfestation if the log ratio is very negative, if the confidence interval is narrow, if the percentage is high, and if the p-value is very low. Okay, that's how to interpret the results. I see a question from Asma. It's again about the literature search. Do we need to store or search when you're searching for article? If yes, how can we do that? Is there any software to store the search to proceed with article screening and finding PDF format or papers? Okay. So it's about the management of the papers retrieved from the literature search. Yes, you have a different type of software that can be used to handle the papers retrieved from literature search. It depends on the type of software you prefer, but you already can do a lot of things with a Web of Science system, because you can obtain the list of papers, you can obtain the abstract of the paper, you can ask a Web of Science to send you all these elements by email. Then to manage the literature search, you have different tools available. If you are familiar with R, with the R software, you can use the Metagir package, for example, which is very handy to deal with paper screening, etc. But if you are not familiar with R, you have other software that can be used to do the same type of things. Now let's back maybe to this result, and we will try to interpret the results. So here you have a simple quiz. You have four statements, A, B, C, D. And some of these statements are true, and other of these statements are wrong. Okay. All the statements, A, B, C, D, are about the result displayed in panel C on fungal pathogen. So you have just to focus on the panel C here. So I give you 2 minutes to read the statements, and you have to type on the chat the statements that you believe are true. Okay, so for example, if you think that B and C are true, you type B and C. But if you think that only A is true, you type A. Okay. So let's go. Okay, there is the first answer. So A, D, true. I agree, A, D, true. Someone say A, B. Other answer. Maybe they are all true, huh? I don't know. That's possible. Maybe they are all wrong. Other answer? Don't be shy. Okay. Okay. So a lot of people say AD. So, okay, let's look at each of them. So, hey, soil disinfestation significantly reduces fungal abundance, all species taken together. To check this one, we have to look at the black points here. Black points is a mean effect size computed across all fungal species, okay? Covering 473 data. So what we see that the mean effect size, the log ratio here, the black points is negative. Negative log ratio means ratio lower than one, means reduction of pest abundance after soil disinfestation. If you look at the p-value, it's significant. And if you look at the confidence interval, the confidence interval does not include zero. Okay. It means that the effect is negative reduction and the effect is significant. So A is correct. Now let's look at B. Soil disinfestation significantly decreases cylindrocarpon abundance. So cylindrocarpon is the blue point here. Cylindrocarpon, it's the second point starting from the bottom. So the blue point is negative. It suggests a reduction of pest abundance, a decrease. But if you look at the confidence interval is very large and it includes zero, okay? And in addition, the p-value is much higher than 5%. It's 0.17. So it means that the effect is not significant. Okay. So B is wrong because there is no significant decrease. There is a decrease, but not significant statistically. So A is true. B is wrong. False. Now, let's look at C. C, salt disinfestation has no significant effect on sclerotinia. If you look at sclerotinia, it's the first blue point starting at the bottom in panel C, from the top in panel C. It's a 15% effectiveness. The blue point is negative, but very close to zero. The confidence interval is not very large, but includes zero. And the p-value is very high. It's 0.52. So here, the effect is clearly not significant. Okay. So we can conclude here that salt disinfestation has no significant effect on sclerotinia. So C is true. The last one, D. Salt disinfestation has a negative but no significant effect on sclerotinia abundance. So it's again on sclerotinia, but the statement is slightly different. It's negative, but not significant. This is correct. It's negative. You see the blue point is lower than zero, but it's not significant. As I said before, confidence interval includes zero, p-value very high. So D is true. So the only false statement is B. So the correct answer was ACD. Do you have questions on this? Because it's important to be able to interpret this kind of results. Another example is the productivity of conservation agriculture. So here it's a paper showing the locations of the experiment considered in a meta-analysis assessing the effect of conservation agriculture. Conservation agriculture is a cropping system combining three principles: no tillage, soil cover with crop residues, and rotation. And a lot of people were promoting conservation agriculture and were saying that it increased yield. So here you see it's a bigger meta-analysis because here it includes more than 600 studies. And if you look at the paper, you will see that, question from Nathalie, why we have to look at the zero when looking at the confidence interval? Oh, I can answer this question with this example. So if you look at the mean effect size estimated with this 610 studies, you have here, so again, it's a relative difference of yield, conservation agriculture against conventional tillage system. When it's negative, it reveals a yield loss, and when it's positive, it reveals a yield gain. Okay. So here you have the overall effect with the confidence interval, and then you have a subset of experiments combining different principles. So the first point corresponds to the combination of the three principles of conservation agriculture, nutillage, rotation, residues. The next one, it's only nutillage plus rotation. The next one is only nutillage plus residue. And the last one at the bottom of the graphic, it's only nutillage without residues, without rotation. So what can we conclude from this graphic? Do we have yield gain or yield loss with conservation agriculture? And in which case is the loss or gain the strongest? So first, do you think that conservation agriculture compared to conventional tillage lead to yield gain or yield loss? This is easy. So you can type loss or gain in the chat if you like. So loss or gain? No, at this stage, you just have to answer loss, yield loss or yield gain. So if you look at the point, is it positive or negative? So for example, the overall effect size covering all the experiments, you see here, it corresponds to -5%. So it's a yield loss of 5%. So based on the synthesis of the 610 studies, we can conclude that there is a yield loss of 5%. Now you have to see whether it's significant or not. To see whether it's significant or not, you have to look at the confidence interval. If the confidence interval, it's a 95% confidence interval. So if the confidence interval includes zero, it will show that it's not significantly different from zero. If it does not include zero, it will show that it's not significantly different, significantly different from zero. It's equivalent to a p-value. So if you have a 95% confidence interval crossing zero, it's like a p-value higher than 5%. If you have a confidence interval not crossing the zero reference, it's like a p-value lower than 5%. But in principle, in practice, it's more informative to show the confidence interval than the p-value, because the p-value is just a yes or no answer, whereas here a confidence interval shows you the plausible range of values for the estimated effect size. So it's always more informative to display a confidence interval than to show a p-value. Now you see that if you combine, if you use only the subset of studies combining nutillage, rotation, and residues, the yield loss is a bit lower. It's around 2.5%. It means that if you want to do nutillage, it's better to combine nutillage with rotation and soil cover of residues. You will limit the risk of yield loss. Instead of having 5%, you will have 2.5%. But still, You can see that if you combine knotted edge rotation and soil cover by residues, the yield loss is significant because the confidence interval does not include zero. It's like a p-value lower than 5%. Okay. Okay, so this is another example. And I will finish the first part of the talk on this. This is a meta-analysis assessing the effect of an increase of temperature on the wheat yield in China based on field warming experiment. It's a compilation of 46 results of field warming experiments located in 11 sites in China. And the quantity calculated by the author is a relative difference of yield between wheat under increased temperature condition and wheat under normal condition in the control. So to warm the temperature, the author used some kind of resistance in the soil or soil lamp, heating lamps above the wheat crops. Then they divided the relative yield change by the difference of temperature between the treatment and the control, multiplied by 100 in order to obtain a yield change in percentage. Here you have in black the individual yield change in percentage obtained in 11 sites in China. So you see that in some sites, the yield tend to increase when the temperature was increased by plus 1 degree Celsius, while in other sites, for example, in Guyana, the yield decreased by almost 10%. If you analyze all the, if you compute the mean effect size of all the black points, you get the red points here, showing no effect. In fact, in average here, you have no effect of an increase of temperature on the yield of wheat. But what you can see that this mean value indicating no effect in average across all sites, but in some sites you have positive effect and negative effect. So an hypothesis is that in a warm area, an increase of 1 degree Celsius of temperature will decrease the crop yield, but in cold area, an increase of temperature of plus 1 degree will be beneficial to the crop and will decrease crop yield. In order to look at this, the author tried to make a regression between the individual yield change and the mean temperature of the sites under consideration. And they indeed found a kind of decreasing trend showing that the yield effect, the effect of plus 1 degree Celsius on yield tend to be positive in cold area where the mean average temperature is around 6 to 8 degrees, but tend to be negative in a warm area when the mean temperature is around 14 degrees Celsius. However, if you look at the confidence interval in blue here, the effect is not significant. Still, it suggests that maybe by doing more experiments, we may find more accurate result showing indeed a relationship between the impact of an increased temperature on crop yield and the average temperature of the sites. To conclude this this part, here is a series of advantages and limits of meta-analysis. Advantages is quantitative. You are able to derive quantitative estimates. You can do an uncertainty analysis through the computation of confidence interval. You can identify knowledge gap You can produce simple regression model from meta-analysis, and the development of meta-analysis stimulates the development of reusable databases, because you have to extract the data from the paper to put that in a spreadsheet, and then step by step you can update the spreadsheet each time a new study is published in the literature. However, meta-analysis have some limits. First, you cannot deal with emerging issues when you do a meta-analysis, because you need, of course, a relatively large number of papers when you want to do a meta-analysis. So when you have to deal with a new topic, you of course, you don't have a lot of paper available, so it's not possible to do a meta-analysis. It's long. It requires about one person day for every two articles. Because it's long and because you have to go through a relatively large number of steps, some meta-analyses are of poor quality. And of course, you need some training. I put some books here that can be useful for you. Two are in English, one in French. So I think most of you are English speakers. So maybe you can have a look at the book in English if you are interested. So here we have a question from Wen Feng. I found that meta-analysis can be published in very high profile journal, but also in low profile journals. If you want to aim at high profile journals, you have to do a meta-analysis on a new topic. That's the main criterion, I think. It should be a new topic for which no meta-analysis was published before. So you have to look at existing meta-analysis. If you have an idea of topic for a meta-analysis, you have to first check how many meta-analyses were published on this topic. If you see that several meta-analyses were already published on this topic, you can make a good meta-analysis on the same topic, but the chance that it will be published in a journal like Science or Nature will be very low, because this kind of journal, they publish only new results. So, for example, if you want to publish, I don't know, a meta-analysis assessing the effect of climate change on crop yields, it was already done several times. So you could publish it in a thematic journal and make a very nice paper, very rigorous work, but it will not be in Nature. I'm finished with this first part. If you have no question on this, I propose a break until 10:45 Paris time. I don't know at what time it will be in China. And then I will start again at 10:45 with the second part of the course. Okay? Here we will consider the step data extraction and computation of the individual effect size for each individual study. In the last part of the course, I will explain how to synthesize all these individual effect sizes in one single mean effect size. But now we are dealing with only data extraction and individual effect size computations. So this part of the course concerns the step number 4 and 5 of the whole process, data extraction and statistical analysis. The objective here is to take each individual experiment like this one and to extract the experimental results in both control and treatment. So for example, if you have an experiment assessing, comparing organic systems and conventional system on wheat crop, for example, wheat crop yield, you will extract the yield data for the organic system and for the conventional system and calculate effect size for this individual experiment. And we will repeat the process for all individual experiments. So the idea is to compute the effect size and assess its uncertainty. So schematically, what you want to do is to compute the black point and the confidence interval in black here for each experiment, for experiment one, for experiment four, for experiment seven, and we want to end up with this graphic displaying all individual effect size and all individual confidence intervals. To do that, we will repeat the following three steps for each single study. First, extract the data. Second, compute the effect size. And third, compute the confidence interval. So first, data extraction. Data extraction are sometimes very easy, sometimes very difficult. It depends on the format of the data available in the individual papers. Sometimes we are lucky, the papers include an external file in which all the experimental data are made available publicly. For example, if you look at the appendix of the paper, you may find a file, I don't know, a .txt file, an Excel file, or something else, including all the data published in the paper, but it's not that frequent. And most often, you don't have this external file and you have to extract the data either from tables or from graphics. If I go back to my meta-analysis on agroforestry and its impact on soil organic carbon sequestration, the author of the meta-analysis extracted the data from many individual papers, and this is one example of such individual paper. And here you see that you have a table including soil organic content at different depths, soil depths. And you also have a graphic on the right showing the soil organic concentration, soil organic stocks, and bulk density at different depths and for different treatments. So basically, what you have to do when you want to extract the data is to take all the numbers in these tables and put it in a spreadsheet. If you don't have tables, you have to extract the data directly from the graphic. To extract data from graphic, you have different tools available to do that. This is one of them. It's free. It's a web plot digitizer. So the principle is to upload the graphic. Here it's an example of graphic showing crop yields. And then you have a pointer here, and you can point on each graphical element and retrieve the coordinate. And from that, you can compute the effect sizes. Once you have extracted the data, you have to compute either differences, ratio, log ratio. It depends on the type of effect size that you have defined. And generally speaking, an effect size is a function of two quantities, the value of the variable of interest in the control and the value of the variable of interest in the experimental treatment. And the effect size is a function of XC and XE. For example, the effect size will be the difference between XE and XC, or the ratio of XE and XC, or the log ratio. There are many types of effect size, difference, standardized difference, ratio, log ratio, odds ratio, correlation, etc. The difference is probably the most simple effect size. It's simply the difference between XE and XC. The reference value is zero. You have a positive treatment effect when D is higher than zero and a negative treatment effect when D is lower than zero. Quite often, people don't use directly the difference. They use the standardized difference, which consists in the difference divided by the standard error of the difference. In this way, the standardized difference is unitless. It does not depend on the unit of measurement. But the most frequent effect size, in particular in agricultural science and in environmental science and in ecology, is the ratio of XE to XC. Here the reference value is one, and you have a positive treatment effect if R is higher than one, and a negative treatment effect otherwise. For statistical reasons, we usually don't analyze the ratio directly, but the logarithm of the ratio. And when R is higher than one, it means that L, the logarithm, is higher than zero. Now we are going to do a small exercise. Imagine that you have an experiment where you compare two groups of animals. One group of 50 broilers with a new feeding strategy, and another group of animals of 50 broilers. Broilers is a chicken, it's a special type of chicken, with a standard feeding strategy. And what we want to do is to measure the effect of the new feeding strategy compared to the standard feeding strategy. And in the experiment, the result are the following. The mean body weight is 552 grams in the experimental treatment with the new feeding strategy. And the mean body weight in the control is 525 grams. And now you have to calculate three effect sizes. D, the difference, not the standardized difference, the simple difference, the ratio, R, and the log ratio, L. So you have a few seconds to do that. You can use your favorite software to do it. I will do it myself. So in principle, you should find D equal 27, R equal the ratio 1.05, and L, the log ratio, 0.05. Okay. So this result shows that the new feeding strategy increases the body weight by 27 grams, and it corresponds to an increase of 5% because the ratio is 1.05. The next step is to compute the confidence interval. This is usually the most complicated step. Because you have to take into account the variability of the observation. So let's consider this experiment, including six replicates. So you have six value of x in the control, six value of x in the experimental treatment. So for example, it can be a six value of body weight in the control and in the experimental treatment, or it can be six measures of soil organic carbon in the cereal cropping system, and six measures of soil organic carbon in the agroforestry system. And then, if you want to calculate the difference, you will compute the mean value of the six replicates in the control and treatment, take the difference, and then what we need is the standard error of the difference. The standard error of the difference is equal to this quantity here. Sigma squared is the variance, okay? So that's the variance measuring the variability of the observation. Sigma square C is the variance in the control. Sigma square E is the variance in the experimental treatment. NC and NE are the number of replicates. Here they are both equal to six. And to get the standard error of the difference here, we take the variance divided by the sample size. We add the value obtained in the control and the treatment, and we take the square root of the sum. Okay. Actually, if you take the variance divided by the sample size, it corresponds to the standard error of the mean squared. Okay. Finally, compute the confidence interval. You take the difference between the two mean values, and you subtract 1.96 multiplied by the standard error of the difference. This is the lower bound of the 95% confidence interval. And to get the upper bound, you take the difference of the mean and you add 1.96 multiplied by the standard error of the difference. And the 1.96 comes from the standard Gaussian distribution. It corresponds to the percentile 97.5% okay, of a standard Gaussian distribution. And you get the lower and upper bound of the confidence interval like this. If you work with a log ratio and not with difference, then you use a slightly different formula to compute the confidence interval. You have to calculate the standard error of the log ratio, and it's almost the same as the standard error of the difference. The only difference here is that you have to divide again by the squared value of the mean values. So here, xc bar square and xe bar square are used as well to compute the standard error of the log ratio. And then the formula for the confidence interval is the same. Quite often, we like to back transform the result into ratio from the log ratio. This is very easy. You have simply to take the exponential of the lower and upper bound of the confidence interval. So if you do that for each individual study, you obtain a series of points like this corresponding to the individual effect size. And to you also get the confidence interval, which will reflect the uncertainty in the individual effect size. So let's do another exercise, a bit more difficult. Now we have one study comparing the yields in organic system and conventional system for a wheat crop. So the experiment consists in two fields, one organic field and one conventional field, the same site and the same year. In the organic field, we have a mean yield of 3.5 tons per hectare, a standard deviation of 1, and a sample size of 4. And in the conventional wheat, we have a mean yield of 5 tons per hectare, a standard deviation of 1.5, and a sample size of 4. Now the question is, compute the log yield ratio. I will do that with you. If you don't understand anything, just ask the question. So the log ratio is minus 0.36. It is negative because the yield is lower in the organic system than in the conventional system. So this is easy. Now we have to calculate the standard deviation, the standard error of the log ratio. Here, sigma C, sigma E is equal to 1. Sigma C is equal to 1.5. And NC equal NE equal 4. XC equal X equal. Right. XC equal 5. Try to do the computation. I obtain sigma L equal 0.27. This is the standard error of the log ratio. And now you have to compute the lower and upper bound of the confidence interval. So the lower bound is 0.36 minus 1.96 because we want to compute a 95% confidence interval. This is the lower bound, and the upper bound is 1.66. Yes, so the answer provided in the chat is correct. So in fact, what we have is an effect size of minus 0.36 and a confidence interval covering the range minus 0.76, 0.049. Okay. This is so the black point will correspond to minus 0.36, and the confidence interval will range from 0.76 to 0.049. You can back transform the result in order to express the result in yield ratio and not in terms of log yield ratio. To do that, you have to calculate exponential minus 0.36. And for the confidence interval, you take the exponential 0.76, exponential 0.049. This is what I got. So what I got is a yield ratio of 0.70. This means a yield loss of about 30%. But you see that the confidence interval is very large here. It ranges from 0.47 to 1.05. It includes the reference value 1. So it's difficult to hear. Basically, there is no significant difference of yield between organic and conventional system. So this is how we compute an individual effect size and its confidence interval for one study. So what is important to understand is that this should be done for each study separately. And it takes time because you have to extract the data and to make this kind of computation. So if you repeat this approach for all studies, you will obtain this kind of graphic. So what we just computed is 1 point and one confidence interval, because we use the result of one experiment. If you do that for all experiments, you will obtain many points and many confidence intervals. Is it clear? Any question? Okay. If you don't have questions, we will go now in part three. We will start the third part of my course. The third part of my course aims at explaining how to compute the mean effect size, how to synthesize all this data in order to calculate a mean effect size. Okay. So I open the part number three. I think you should see the slide. Okay. So in the previous part, we have seen together how to calculate the individual effect sizes and the confidence interval. Now we will see how to calculate the red point here and the red confidence interval based on all the individual effect sizes and their confidence intervals. So to estimate this mean effect size and confidence interval, we have to take into account the distribution of the individual effect sizes, the within-study variability reflected by the length of the individual confidence intervals, and the between-study variability. And when we will get the red point, the estimated mean effect size, we will compare the confidence interval and the mean effect size to a reference value. If it's a difference, it will be zero. If it's a log ratio, it will be zero. If it's a ratio, it will be one. Okay. Let's consider it's a log ratio. So here we see that the red confidence interval does not cross the value zero. So here there is evidence of difference, okay? There is a significant negative effect in average across all studies. Here, on the opposite, the red confidence interval includes a zero, and there is thus no evidence of difference. To compute the red points and the red confidence interval, there are several methods, fixed effect models, random effect models, and Bayesian methods. I will briefly present the first two, the fixed effect models and the random effect models. I will not have time to introduce Bayesian methods, it's more technical. But you have to know that the most popular approach now to compute the mean effect size is the second one, the random effect models. So if you have to use one method, use the random effect model. First, I present the fixed effect model. It is the simplest model. And you have to understand one important thing. It's that the fixed effect model assumes that all studies share the same effect size. It means that according to the fixed effect model, there is no variation of the effect size across studies. This is a mathematical expression of the fixed effect model. It's a very simple statistical model. Li is the effect size estimated in the study number I. For example, Li will be typically a log ratio. Mu is a true mean effect size that we want to estimate. Mu is in fact the value of the red point. And epsilon I is the difference between Li and mu. It is a residual error. In the fixed effect model, we consider that the variance of the individual effect size Li is equal to the variance of epsilon I is equal to sigma I square here. And this sigma I square correspond to what we estimated before. It is correspond to the standard error that we calculated in the chat a few minutes ago. Okay, so each individual study will get its own standard error. Based on the fixed effect model, the mean effect size mu, the red point, is calculated as a weighted average of the individual effect size. This is the formula. If you don't understand the formula, it's not a big deal. The big sigma is just the sum. Wi is the weight. A specific weight is associated to each individual effect size Li. And the weight is equal to 1 divided by the standard error of the individual effect size. So previously, we estimated, for example, if I go back to the chat, you remember in my experiment, the sigma, the standard error of the log yield ratio was 0.207, okay? So the weight will be for this experiment 1 divided by 0.207 squared. It means that when a study has a high standard error, the weight is low. And when a study has a low, small standard error, the weight is high. The variance of the mean effect size is 1 divided by the sum of the weight. And from this variance, we can calculate the confidence interval of the mean effect size using the standard formula based on the Gaussian distribution. So again, we see here the mean effect size estimate plus and minus 1.96. multiplied by the standard error of the mean effect size. So it's the same formula as before. There are two differences. Here, it's not the individual effect size, but the mean effect size. And it's not the standard error of the individual effect size, but the standard error of the mean effect size. Now, let's have a look at the random effect model. As I said, the random effect model is now the most frequent approach in meta-analysis. The big difference between the random and fixed effect model is that in the random effect model, we consider that the effect size varies across studies. We consider here that there is a between-study variability in the effect size. And the effect size distribution is described by a probability distribution. This is why it's called a random effect model. This is because we use a probability distribution to describe the between study variability of the effect size. Here you have, you can look at the mathematical expression of the random effect model. So here, Li is the effect size estimated in the study number high. Mu is the true mean effect size over all studies. And Bi is the study-specific effect. Epsilon I is the difference between Li and mu plus Bi. Compared to the fixed effect model, there is, in fact, only one difference. The difference is Bi. The presence of a study-specific effect describing the between-study variability. And because of this study-specific effect, you have now two different variances, the between-study variance sigma b squared and the within-study variances sigma I squared. Sigma I squared is the same variance as the one used in the fixed effect model, but sigma b squared is something additional. It's something new. In fact, the random effect model has an additional parameter compared to the fixed effect model. This new parameter is sigma b squared, the between study variance. To estimate the mean effect size using a random effect model, we use exactly the same formula as in the fixed effect model. Again, the mean effect size here is estimated as a weighted sum of the individual effect size. However, the weight is slightly different in the fixed effect model. The weight were 1 divided by sigma I squared, but here, in the random effect model, the weight is equal to 1 divided by sigma b squared plus sigma I squared. It means that the weight will tend to be lower in the random effect model because of the use of the between study variance sigma b squared. And of course, you will need to estimate this between study variance. And to estimate this between study variance, we use a statistical software. In particular, we can use R to make the computation. When sigma b square is estimated, we can directly compute the standard error of the log ratio and calculate again the confidence interval as before. Now you have to answer a few questions. I want to check that you understand a little my explanations. Don't be afraid. I don't care if it's if you are correct or not. Huh? Now, in a fixed effect model, so this is a statement. You have to say whether it's true or false. In a fixed effects model, all studies have the same weight. Is it true or false? Now, I can go back to the fixed effect model slide. So here, you have the formula used to calculate the mean effect size. As I said, it's a weighted average of the individual effect size, and the weight are equal to 1 divided by the variance of the individual effect size. Now I go back to the question. So true or false? False, correct. Ah, one true. It's false because it's false because here you see the mean effect size. It's a weighted average. Okay. So here the weight is 1 divided by the variance of the study I. And there is no reason that all studies share the same variance. You will have, for example, studies included a high number of replicates and studies including a low number of replicates, study with a high or low variability. So depending on the number of replicates and within study variability, you will have high or low weight. So in a fixed effect model, the different studies have different weight. Second question. In a random effect model, all studies have the same weight. True or false? I go back to the equation. It's again a weighted average. So each study I has a weight, which depends again on sigma I squares. So in general, the weights will be different because each study has its own sigma I square. So the answer is false. When there is a strong between study variability, a random effect model is often appropriate. True or false? The random effect model assumes that the effect size varies across studies. And a fixed effect model assumes that there is no variability across studies, that all studies share the same effect size. So when you have a strong between study variability, usually you should use a random effect model. The random term is used to describe the between study variability. So if you have a large between study variability, you need a random effect model to describe it. Okay. It is important to understand. So here the BI is there to describe the study effect. If you have no between study variability, actually you don't need a random effect model. You can use a fixed effect model. But in most cases, in particular in environmental science, ecology, and agricultural science, you will have a strong between study variability, and this is why we usually use a random effect model. So here it's true. In fact, to choose between fixed and random, you have to answer this question. Does the true effect size vary from study to study? If the answer is yes, you have to use a random effect model. And if the answer is no, you can use a fixed effect model. In practice, it's often yes. This is why most of the people use a random effect model. And to decide whether it's a yes or no, you have two approaches. The first approach is a graphical analysis, and the second approach is a statistical test. Testing the null hypothesis, all studies share a common effect size. And you have a specific test, very popular, named the Q statistical test, able to answer this question, whether all studies share a common effect size or not. So formally, in the Q statistical test, we have the individual effect size estimated in P studies, for example, 50 studies, and we test the hypothesis that they are all equal. Now, so if you have questions, just ask. Huh? It's important to understand this. If it's clear, now we are going to see how to perform simple meta-analysis with the software RStudio. But you have several packages to do a meta-analysis. You can use NLME, LME4, but in my view, in particular for beginners, I think it's better to use metaphor. So what I recommend is the metaphor. R package. It will allow you to fit random effect models and to make nice plots and to compute mean effect size, confidence intervals, perform statistical tests, and so on. You can find a lot of information on metaphor in this open source, paper. I will show you the basic principle. So I expect here that you have some basis in R. If you never use R before, you will have difficulty to follow here, but for R users, I think everything will be very clear. So the key function in metaphor is the function RMA. Random model analysis. And there are many arguments in RMA, but the main arguments are YI, VI, and method. YI is the object including the individual effect sizes. The I is the object including the variance of the individual effect sizes, and method will specify whether you use a fixed effect or a random effect model. You run the function, you store the result in an object called a fit here, and by using summary fit, you will get the main results. And by running forest fit, you will get the plot, the forest plot, with all the individual effect size and the mean effect size. Yes, okay. So this is a typical R script structure for a meta-analysis. So you have a first part where you upload the data. You may have a part where you have some data preparation code for specifying maybe the vectors, including individual effect size and their variance. Then you have some visualization to check that the data are correctly read. Then you run RMA and you summarize the result. And finally, you draw the forest plot and the funnel plot. So as an exercise, and to illustrate how it works, I will use a data set from this paper comparing the yields of organic and conventional agriculture. So the objective is to estimate the mean yield loss in organic versus conventional system. So here we have a data set, including experiments, many experiments. And in each experiment, you have two plots, one plot corresponding to the control, it's a conventional system, and one plot corresponding to the treatment, it's an organic system. And the objective is to compute the yield ratio, organic versus conventional, the mean yield ratio across a large number of individual experiments. I send you the code by mail. If you know how to use R, you can run it very easily. The first line of code is just to read the library metaphor. Then here I read the external file, including the data. So here, this is the name of the external file. The file itself is like a spreadsheet. Here I just show a few columns of the spreadsheet. So each row is one experiment. So here you have the mean yield in the conventional system, the standard deviation, the number of replicates in the conventional system. Here you have the mean yield in the organic system. Here the standard deviation in the organic system and the number of replicates. You have the unit. You have the log ratio. So the log ratio is, for example, here it's 23.15 divided by 32.29. And we take the log of this ratio and we obtain this value. And for the variance, and the last column is the variance of the log ratio. It's the variance that we will use to weight the studies. It's called the sigma I square in my slides. And it's based on the formula we have seen before. We have done a small exercise in the second part of the course. It's exactly the same formula here. This is just to display the data. So if I open R, so this is the code here. So I have to select the correct directory. This is important. So here I select the directory where the data are stored. And now if I run this first line of code, Here I see the first rows of the dataset. You see the first experiment was done in India on paper. The second experiment was done in Sweden on wheat and so on. So it's just to check that we are able to read the data. The next part of the code is a metaphor. So I see there is a question from Asma asking based on what we choose, which method we use for the LEMMA function. So now I will explain this. So here I run RMA using the method FE, fixed effect. Okay. And as I said before, if I find a strong between study variability of the individual effect size, I will change and use a random effect model instead of a fixed effect model. But I start with a fixed effect model to show you how it works. For the argument corresponding to the individual effect size, I put the name of the columns of the data set, including the individual effect size. And for the variance, I use the name of the column, including the variance. If I go back to my file, you see here, the name of the column, including the individual effect size, is LNR, like logarithm of the ratio. And the variance is var LNR, variance of the log ratio. This is the name I wrote here, okay? And now if I write summary, I got the result. If I run it on R, I will get the result here, you see. Okay, this is exactly what is shown on my slide. And here I have the mean effect size estimate. This is the mean log ratio of a yield inorganic to conventional. And here you see that it's negative, and you see that it's significant. The p-value here is very low. And here you have the confidence interval. LB is for lower bound and UB is for upper bound. You see that the confidence interval do not cover the zero value. It means that I have a significantly negative value indicating a yield loss. So how big is the yield loss? If you want to know, you have to take the exponential of this. So for example, if I take exponential minus 0.25, I get 0.78, it's about 22% of yield loss. Okay, so this value corresponds to 22% of yield loss in average across all studies. How many studies I have? It's written here. Here you see that I had 65 studies. So in my data set here, in fact, I have 65 rows. I don't show them all here, only the first few are displayed. But I have 65 rows, and here I can find the number of studies. So here we have the mean effect size, the confidence interval. And here there is something interesting here as well. This is still the same outcome. Huh? It's the heterogeneity, test for heterogeneity. It's the Q statistical test. Here we can see that the Q statistical test is highly significant. Okay. And here I have a number, 96%. It's the fraction of the total variability due to the between study variability compared to the within study variability. So it means that almost all the variability of my individual effect size are due to a between study variability. This is confirmed by the test of heterogeneity,
which indicates that I cannot consider that all studies share the same effect size. As this test is highly significant, in fact, I should not choose a fixed effect model. For this reason, I will change the method here. Instead of using this method, I will change it. I will change the name and shift for a random effect model. Before that, I show you how to back transform the results with R in order to express the result in ratio, yield ratio, and not log ratio. So here I make a transformation exponential of the lower, this lower bound, this is upper bound. And then I print the result and I directly have the result expressed in yield ratio. So here I have 0.678 and a confidence interval. So here you can see that the confidence interval is very small. Huh? It looks very accurate, but keep in mind that here we don't use a good model. We use a fixed effect model, which is in contradiction with the result of the statistical test. So in fact, we should not believe too much in this result. What we should do is to use a random effect model. And to use a random effect model, you have to replace method FE by method REML. Then you run the model again, and you obtain a new estimate, new confidence interval. Okay, and here the confidence interval is wider. It's more realistic, in fact. Before, we were assuming that all studies were sharing the same effect size, which was completely unrealistic according to the Q statistical test. So by shifting for a random effect model, now we have a more realistic confidence interval. It's larger, but it's more realistic. If I back transform the result, now I obtain, in fact, the same mean yield ratio, 0.78, corresponding to a yield loss of 22%. But now the confidence interval is a bit larger. It ranged from 0.73 to 0.85. It means that the loss is something between 27% of yield loss to 15%. So it's between 27 and 15% of yield loss according to this meta-analysis. If you want to obtain a forest plot summarizing all the individual effect size and the mean effect size together in the same graphic, you can write forest fit and you will get this kind of graphic. So here you have study one, study two, study three, up to study 65. Each square here corresponds to the individual effect size here. Okay. Together with their confidence interval. So you see, for example, that study 9 is characterized by the strong yield loss and it's very accurate, but study 3 is very inaccurate. You have a very large confidence interval. On the right, you have the numerical value. The first number corresponds to the value of the black square. And the next values correspond to the lower and upper bound of the confidence interval. Finally, at the bottom of the graphic, you have a lozenge here, point here. These points correspond to the mean effect size. It's equal to minus 0.24. It's exactly the value displayed here. Okay. And the confidence interval, in fact, corresponds to the width of the point. Okay. And you can see the value again here between the square bracket. In RStudio, to generate that, you simply have to run the model, RMA, and then to run forest fit. And you will see the graphic appearing on the right here. Okay. So it's very convenient, actually. So here you have the individual effect sizes, the 65 individual effect size, and here you have the mean effect size. So here we can conclude that in average, organic system lead to a yield loss of about 22%. And we are not sure whether it's 27 or 15%, but in average, the most possible value is 22%. Last, I would like to show you how to do a subgroup analysis. So this 2065 studies cover all the world, but you might be interested in focusing on one particular region of the world. For example, you would like, you may like to calculate the mean yield loss of organic system compared to conventional system in Asia. If you look at the data set, there is a column in the data set reporting the continent. I can show it here. It's a bit ugly, but I can open it on Excel. It will be better. Here we are. So here you have the data set in Excel. So here you have the study number, the crop species, the country, and here you have continent. And you see that some of the studies are in Asia. Here you have India. Turkey was allocated to Asia, China, and so on. And if you want to select only these studies in Asia, you have to write subset tab dollar continent equal Asia, and then the next lines of code are exactly the same. And you get another new result based on a smaller data set, including only the few studies conducted in Asia. Okay, so study 1, 7, 9, 12, etc. were conducted in Asia. And here you have the mean effect size for Asia, minus 0.34. With this confidence interval here, pretty large. This is the mean yield ratio, so it means a mean yield loss of 29% in Asia, but the confidence interval is very large. And the confidence interval is very large because you have only few studies in Asia in the dataset. You have 9 studies. So if you want to see how it works directly on RStudio, you just have to select this piece of code here, and you get here the forest plot and the result. So I'm almost finished with the course. If you have a question, just ask. Of course, for people not familiar with R, this should be a bit difficult to follow. But if you know R, I think it's straightforward. So the last step when you do a meta-analysis is to analyze bias and uncertainty. So for bias, you have different tools. But one very popular tool is publication bias based on funnel plot. Funnel plot is a plot like this. It shows the individual effect size on the x-axis and the standard error on the individual effect size on the y-axis. And the idea is to see whether the plot is symmetrical or not. If it's not symmetrical, it may suggest a publication bias. Publication bias is a bias resulting from the preferential publication of studies showing significant results, meaning that the studies with insignificant results may have not been published. And this can lead to a bias, to an overestimation of the effect of the treatment. Another interesting tool is the prediction interval. We already see the confidence interval. This is again the meta-analysis organic versus conventional. So you see here the mean effect size, the confidence interval. But you may like to get a prediction interval. Prediction interval is different. The confidence interval focuses on the mean effect size. The prediction interval tries to estimate the plausible range of value for a new situation. So in this case, it will be for a new field. What will be the expected yield loss that you could get in a new field if you shift from conventional to organic system? And prediction intervals are usually much larger than confidence interval because their objective is not to estimate a mean value, but a new individual effect for a new situation. That's it. I have finished my course. I hope it was relatively clear for you. And now it's your turn. You have to choose a topic to extract the data and to run a meta-analyse. And if you need some help, don't hesitate to contact me by email. And if you have still a few questions, I can take a couple of questions now.
Thanks so much for this. I think it's a very interesting and the topic. Interesting and useful, and also I think a very detailed presentation about the meta-analysis. It gave all the principle how to give this meta-analysis, and also I think most important is that David also gave some example to do this with R. Maybe some people are not familiar with R, or maybe more familiar with Python, but it's I think it's okay. We can handle this. At least this gives us a very good example how to do this. If you are interested, I think we can choose a good example, good topic to actually follow this this course. And then I think you can make a big difference and maybe you can also publish a very nice paper. Thanks, David, again. And I think we still have some time for several questions. Mm-hmm. If anybody wants to ask her, I think David will be happy to answer.
So there is a question about mixed effect model. So mixed effect model, it's in fact a random effect model, but with covariates explaining part of the between study variability using some characteristic of the experiment. For example, if you want to explain the differences between the effect sizes across studies using, I don't know, the average temperature or the soil type, or I don't know, the soil depth, you may have this information as a fixed effect in the random effect model, and then you get a mixed effect model. And this type of model can be also fitted using the RMA function of the metaphor package. So there is another question. If the variability is not due to between study variability, how to investigate the source of variability then? If it's not the between study variability, it's due to the between replicates variability. So it's either if you have an experiment in a single year, if you have a single year experiment, the within study variability is usually only the spatial variability. If you have a multi-year experiment, then the within study variability is partly due to the spatial variability and partly due to the between year variability. So if you have all the replicates and all the results for each year, then you can investigate whether this variability is due more to the spatial variability or to the between year variability. But if you don't have all the details, if you don't have all the data for all years and all replicates, then it will be difficult to know. And I have a question for you, Wenfeng. In your institute, what would be the key topics on which it will be interesting to do a meta-analysis?
Actually, in our institute, we focus very much kind of about the water issue. Regarding especially the irrigation, how to improve the irrigation performance, and how to use the irrigation method to improve the crop performance and to reduce the water use. This is actually the topic we focus quite a lot. But at the same time, we are also quite interested in the climate change and some also about the carbon issue. Actually, here I have one question that related to the to select a topic, because for example, if we select a very hot topic, there are quite a very large number of publications. And if we select a topic that maybe is not so popular, the paper will be limited. Sometimes, of course, the topic will be related to the project. But sometimes, if we only want to do a meta-analysis, no matter which kind of topic, I just wonder what's your opinion that how can we choose a topic? I mean, from your opinion, do you have any suggestion? If we, I mean, we don't care about which kind of project, we just want to do a meta-analysis. For example, we can have some undergraduate student to do some simple analysis, and then which kind of topic we need to consider, you think?
First, you have to specify a little bit, not the precise topic, but at least the area of research. For example, water use efficiency can be a good general theme of research. And then within this general theme, you can specify the topic for a new meta-analysis by doing a literature search covering all meta-analyses, for example, on water use efficiency. And then you see what was done and what was not done. And finally, you define the topic on the knowledge gap, on something that was not already considered in previously published meta-analysis. You see what I mean? So for example, if your institute work on water use, irrigation, and so on, you can do a literature search using keyword water use, irrigation, meta-analysis. Then you look at all the meta-analysis published on this topic already. And finally, you identify a gap. And based on this gap, you define a new topic for a new meta-analysis.
Okay, I see. But another question is that because sometimes some topic, they are very popular. There are thousands of the papers published in this topic, but some other topic maybe not, maybe only less than 100 papers. How should we deal with it? You think maybe the topic with less publication will be more relevant or the very, because I think it's both of the cases will be difficult to handle. One is too much and one is maybe too less.
Yeah, that's a very frequent difficulty. What is very important is to define as precisely as possible the topic of the meta-analysis. I mean, the population of studies, the intervention, the control, and the effect size. If you define that very precisely, usually the number of papers will not be too high, I think. But it's very frequent to have something like 1,000 papers to screen. And it's not impossible to deal with that, because what you can do is first screen on title and abstracts. and screening a large number of papers on titles and abstracts. Even some people just look at titles quite often in order to be even faster. It's not too long to do that. And you will be able to eliminate maybe 80% of the papers. So at the end, even if you have 1,000 papers, you will get something like between 100 and 200 papers for full text reading. And this will be feasible.
Yes.
So my advice is first to define as precisely as possible the scope by writing population intervention comparator outcome. And then to do the search, and then to screen by titles, and if possible, abstract. I see that there is another question in the chat. I think it's an interesting question, because each study could correspond to a time series rather than a specific value. So the question is how to deal with time series. You will have to summarize the time series in some way. So for example, if you are interested in the time trends, what you have to do is to fit a time trend to each time series and then to make a meta-analysis on the estimated trends. Or if you are interested in some extreme value, you will have to estimate the extreme value for each time series separately and then make a meta-analysis of the extreme values. So it means that you will have to define one or several quantities summarizing each time series. And this definition is part of the scoping of the meta-analysis. You have to define very precisely the question. So if the question is on the trend, you will make a meta-analysis on the trend. If the question is on the extreme, you will make a meta-analysis on the extreme, and so on. It can be on the seasonality or on each of the component of the time series decomposition.
Yes, I think we're almost done. Okay, then, if we have no more questions, we can close this lecture. And thank David again for your very nice talk. And we will, as I already mentioned that at the beginning of this course, we have another course about machine learning. Mm-hmm. I think this is another very interesting and hot topic in the, of course, in many topics, field, agriculture, environment, and kind of climate change. There are quite a lot of field are trying to use the machine learning method mm-hmm. to do some computation. And to compare it with the physical based model. So I think in October, we will advise this new lecture and I hope that we will sit together to find some interesting. And at some time, we hope that this lecture about the meta-analysis will stimulate more research and or of course, some possible collaboration between CAU and Zealand and IHA in the near future. And okay, that's what I want to say. Do you have something to add, David or John?
No, well, thank you for the invitation and see you soon for the second lecture.